Global attacks on encryption are happening literally everywhere. I just talked about this in recent videos. You guys definitely paid attention. And a lot of you might not know about which encrypted tools to use. These are seven categories of encrypted services that I think probably everybody needs or at least should know about, with individual recommendations within each category. When you're using the services in this video, you are pushing back against the narrative that encryption is only for criminals or bad guys. Even though the government's trying to outlaw this, use encryption all the time themselves. So use it and keep yourself safe. Let's get into the services. Password managers are a good starting point because this is your gateway to quite literally everything in your life. Besides something that'll make it easy for you to generate strong, secure, unique passwords across all your services, password managers are also really good from just a usability perspective. If you're looking for the most secure thing out there, KeePass is open source and is very flexible, though offline and a bit more DIY by default. Proton Pass is what I'm using right now. It's open source and encrypted. It integrates with email aliases and it's very easy to use, and it's something I've been recommending to friends and family as well, as probably the most mainstream friendly password manager that happens to also be open source. Many people in our community also like Bitwarden though, so that's another open source option. And then if you want something more family slash enterprise slash professional, 1Password does pivot itself here. It's not open source, but a lot of people in our community still like it, and they are a very competent team that has a very good security track record. No matter what password manager you pick, make sure it's properly secured and has a good 2FA method, so you can't just get into there with 1Password. Next step is for you to establish a safe place to communicate with your loved ones. Many people use WhatsApp, but you should probably avoid WhatsApp. I have a video on that if you want to learn why it's not as private as they market themselves to be. Personally, my go-to is Signal. I think it's a great balance of usability, privacy, and security that fits most people's threat models and what they're looking for, and it's extremely accessible to the average person. If you want something a bit more hardcore than Signal, we have decentralized things like Session, which in some ways do offer a few more privacy and anonymity benefits than Signal, but I do think it starts adding some usability concerns right away for new people you're trying to onboard to actually use these messengers. Similarly, SimpleX is in a similar place. They have some really cool tech, really cool privacy and security stuff going on, but the usability experience just isn't quite where Signal's at yet. If you want something even more extreme, there's Briar, which is peer-to-peer, and it goes, it's Tor routed, it does all this crazy stuff. It's really cool. I've done a dedicated review on that a long time ago, but it's really gonna push the usability to security ratio that you're looking for. And finally, I leave it last, but there's Threema. Threema actually is very usable and is a very well-regarded messenger with very solid privacy and security practices. Just know that it is paid. So if you're okay with paying for something yourself and convincing others to pay for it, Threema might actually be a solid option here as well. I just don't personally aim for it first because I have a hard enough time getting people to move to Signal, which is free. So I can't imagine asking them to pay for a messenger. Email's a tricky topic because email is inherently going to have some challenges when it comes to making it properly private, which is why I recommend having a safe messenger first. With that said, if you're looking at private email providers that offer some improvements, ProtonMail is a staple. They've made a big name for themselves, even outside of privacy spaces, and they offer a very compelling service. It's what I'm using right now, and it's what we use for business, and I really enjoy it overall, and I don't think you can really go wrong with ProtonMail. Tuda is another email provider. Like Proton, it's entirely open source, and they also have really solid encryption. In fact, I would argue a bit better than Proton in some ways. Just be aware that the usability, in my opinion, isn't quite there with Proton, but it's still very good and is something worth checking out. The third one here is Startmail, which is an encrypted email provider as well. They have some really cool encryption options, and I actually think the usability of this is up there with Proton, if not slightly better in some contexts, but it's not open source, and there are no free plans for you to try it out, whereas Proton and Tuda have some free plans. Either way, all three of these are probably going to give you substantial improvements over any typical free email provider that you're familiar with. So check them all out. All right, I always gotta be careful with this section because I don't wanna go around making people think that they just install a VPN and they're done, which is why I don't make it the number one thing in this video in the first category, so you watch it and go, I got a VPN and I'm done, because it's a very small part of the journey. Long story short, VPNs do offer some privacy advantages. They prevent websites from basically just seeing your IP address and seeing that you access 10 different websites and going, well, it's the same person because they have the same IP address. There are other ways for websites to tie you together, but this breaks one of the most common patterns. On our VPN chart, you're going to see top recommendations from a privacy perspective. You're going to have Mulvad VPN, which has been historically one of the best, if not the best, in the space for probably a decade now. iVPN is also up there. Both of those accept Monero payments. They're fully open source, and they're doing literally the best practices of any VPN in the industry right now, and neither of them even have affiliate plans. Proton VPN is also in the list. It's currently what I'm using. I'm using the browser extension myself right now, and I still have Mulvad tied to my Tailscale account, But Proton is still pretty solid. It's not quite as cutting edge as iVPN and Mulvad, but if you're already in the Proton ecosystem, Proton VPN is more than adequate for most people. And then of course we have Windscribe, which is a little bit more mainstream friendly perhaps. And yes, they still are open source and offer a lot of the cool privacy and security tech, but I feel like they still have a lot of cool, very mainstream features that make them a bit more accessible to some of you out there. The next few categories are going to be about data that you're creating, sorting, videos, documents, etc. And we're gonna start with just basic cloud storage. So this is when you have tons of documents and you need to store them somewhere that's not just on a local hard drive, and you need basic encryption so that the other random people can't just access your data. When you use something like Google Drive, Google handles the encryption keys for your account. So theoretically, they can access your data, which means any employees, third-party contractors, etc., can also access some of your Google data. Does that mean they're doing that? It's hard to know, but the fact the possibility is there should make people raise their eyebrows given how much sensitive content they're storing there. A really good service that, yes, is self-hosted, though there are some hosting providers that I do think people should consider, is Nextcloud. Nextcloud really tries to be as close to like a Google suite as they possibly can, all under one hub. It's completely open source, and a lot of people prefer to self-host Nextcloud so they run it on their own hardware and it's their own personal cloud. With that said, you can actually go through a different host, and Nextcloud has finally released some really solid end-to-end encryption tools. Now, if you're looking for more of a typical Google Drive, just sign up and forget it kind of service, we have Proton Drive to start, which is in the Proton ecosystem. It would be awesome to have a Linux client for it, but seriously, it's open source, and on platforms that they have a client, it's super solid now and it's getting better and better. They're starting to get cool sharing features, and it has some basic document editing as well as like a drop folder that I've been using recently for other people to drop things into. FileLand is another service that people really enjoy, and it's going to offer some really solid cloud storage, and it is also end-to-end encrypted. Finally, there's Mega, which is a bit of an oddball with some interesting history, but as of right now, they have source available code and they have some really cool tech to try to guarantee that their encryption is end-to-end encrypted via their extension in the web, for example. The usability of Mega is pretty solid, and honestly, I think if you're using Mega, you're better off from a privacy and security perspective than if you're using most other services. And given the usability and the cost factor, it's not a terrible place to be. Now, file encryption is where things get interesting. So what if you need to use Google Drive? What if you don't trust one of the services I just listed? This is where encrypting your own data before it touches any other computer or any other cloud provider, same thing, really comes into play. So Cryptomator is a whole thing. I made a whole tutorial on it if you want to learn more, but this allows you to essentially use something like Google Drive with end-to-end encryption. So what happens is you install Cryptomator, it's open source, and then you get Google Drive installed as well, and then it essentially encrypts the documents before it touches Google Drive, and it pretty much is just syncing encrypted data over Google Drive, and then if your other device also has Cryptomator, it can decrypt that data. If you picked a good cloud storage provider that has end-to-end encryption already, for most people that's enough, but having this extra option there adds a lot of flexibility and gives you a lot more freedom to do what you want to do. Now, Veracrypt is an option that's better for local storage. Veracrypt allows you to do a ton of cool stuff, like set up encrypted containers on your computer that store hidden files. You can have this on a flash drive. You can add full disk encryption to some drives as well. It's really powerful, and when you really combine these tools together, you can have some really crazy workflows. Of course, don't forget built-in operating system tools, which can be a lot simpler and accessible to most people. macOS has File Vault, which I can't think of any good reason to tell you not to enable. So if you have a Mac, just go into your settings, enable File Vault. Make sure to save your recovery key, of course, and then just enjoy the benefits, and you probably won't notice a difference. On Windows, there's BitLocker, which is going to give you a similar experience, which I also think almost everybody should enable. And if you want something a little bit simpler, or maybe it's a tool you already have on your computer, a lot of archiving tools like 7-Zip, WinRAR, etc., allow you to password encrypt zip files. These aren't the most secure ways to do things, but if you're just looking for like a quick little basic encryption tool for something that's not that sensitive, those are options as well. Okay, and now I have this broad seventh category, which kind of just fills in the gaps from this video so far, which is notes, docs, and photos. Encrypted is a service I really enjoy. It's fully open source. They support docs, they support photos, and it's just the most minimal, clean experience I've seen in almost any software. I've had an account for a long time. It is fully in the web, so this isn't meant to be like a Apple Photos replacement. It's meant to be a secure little place where you can keep everything in the web away from maybe your typical photo library. At least that's kind of how I use it. Ente is another option for end-to-end encrypted photos, which is more of what I just said, which is a photo library replacement. So this is like Google Photos, but with end-to-end encryption. For most people, this is a really nice usable service. It's gonna have facial recognition features that are done on device. It's open source, end-to-end encrypted. To be honest, this is a really easy service to recommend to friends and family because it's fairly usable and pretty easy to set up and import from Google Photos. NotSnook is a notes provider that's open source and end-to-end encrypted, and they, I'd say, are more like a Obsidian-esque kind of notes provider that is all in the cloud as well as local programs. So that's something else that you can use for your end-to-end encrypted notes. I will reintroduce Proton Docs, so you can do some basic document editing and document storage and document creation inside of Proton Drive. Just be aware it's a bit limited, but it does have collaborative features, which is pretty cool, and they actually work decently. And they bought Standard Notes, but you can still just use Standard Notes. So Standard Notes is another popular open source end-to-end encrypted provider for notes. And there's CryptPad, it's like Google Drive with docs, spreadsheets, etc. Open source, end-to-end encrypted. Now those are 7 main categories, and you might be going, oh my gosh, that was so much. Now, most of those have free plans that you can check out. And again, there's links in the description. But if this is overwhelming and you want just simple, I don't care, I don't want to pick all these different services, here's 2 honorable mentions to throw your way. First, I mentioned Proton a lot today. The way I like to describe Proton, and I know they're Swiss-based, but that's not the intention here, it is kind of like a Swiss Army knife. So it's got kind of almost everything you need. You might be able to find better tools in certain areas that you can swap in, but it's not a bad starting point. And for a lot of people, they just kind of use the Proton ecosystem, and that's all they need to use. I mean, I'm going through the list here with Proton. You have Proton Pass, you have email, you have a VPN, you have cloud storage, and you don't really need file encryption. And you also have some docs and even some basic photo support. So the only thing missing in these categories is a messenger. Are there better services in some of those categories? Perhaps. But my point is, if you just kind of want to get started with something and not think too much about this, Proton's not bad. Second honorable mention, if you're looking for something similar, which is, oh my gosh, I don't want to think about this, I just want something simple. The Apple ecosystem right now is okay. I will say the Apple ecosystem requires you to be locked into the Apple ecosystem, not just in software, but in hardware and in spirit. And on top of that, data portability in the Apple ecosystem is not fantastic. If you ever tried sharing something with a non-Apple user, you'll know it's a bit rough around the edges. But if you're somebody already in the Apple ecosystem, and a lot of these services feel like a lot, you can do something very simple right now, which is go into your iCloud settings and enable advanced data protection, unless you're in the UK. More on that there. When you do this, make sure to save your recovery key, or else Apple will not be able to recover your data. So you're now in control of your data, and this will literally end-to-end encrypt everything in your Apple iCloud account, with the exception of email, contacts, and calendar, all things that are covered by either Proton or Tuda. This means all your files, all your notes, all your photos, your backups, everything is end-to-end encrypted within that ecosystem. Is it what I'd recommend to everybody? No. Is it a substantial improvement for the average person? Yes. With that said, I hope I gave you a good breakdown on how to build kind of your privacy and security stack to kind of get you set up with encryption. Besides everything going on in the world right now and ensuring that encryption is something that you're using to fight back against a lot of this language that's happening, encryption is just important for basic ownership. When something is encrypted and end-to-end encrypted, it's actually, to some extent, your data. You can never say something is your data if it's sitting on someone's server and they can access it as well. Treat encryption like the basic human right it deserves to be. I want to thank you all for watching. Again, links to everything are down in the description, and you can also check out our resources on our website. Some links down below are affiliate links, but as you'll see, they're opt-in, and many of the providers that I'm listing have no affiliate programs. I also want to thank our supporters, who I call our Techlorians, for being a part of things and being engaged in our Signal group and also being in our forum and supporting us on a monthly basis to keep all this cool content free for all of you. Thank you for supporting us. If you also want to support us, you can check out all that info down below, and I'll see you guys next time on Techlore.